KP's Video News, y'all. I don't know what's going on with my computer, but I've been trying to, I don't know. Something's going on here. Anyway, I'm going to do a short today because I was trying to do a video. I don't know what's going on, but it keeps stopping for some reason. Anyway, keeping in the history of Black History Month, we have a Black woman that is now the majority owner of a new multi-million dollar film and television studio in Atlanta, Georgia. And Tammy Williams has over 25 years experience in the film television industry, and she has written and produced a plethora of projects such as films, biographies, documentaries, entertainment, and network news. Williams also owned her first digital production company called Tammy Dale Films, 2016, and is now the first Black woman to own a $135 million studio and post-production facility in Atlanta, Georgia. Williams and her business partner, Gary Guidry, an investor and CEO of G Square Events and Black Promoters Collective, founded Cinema South Studios. "We've been patient," she said. "This has not been an overnight thing, and the vision for us," Williams has worried, has worked toward making her dream a reality for 12 years. So she's been in the business for 25 years, and she's been working on this studio for the last 12 years. They will begin to break ground in March for Cinema South Studios, located north of Fayette County. The studio will occupy 60 acres and intends to have 11 sound stages, a backlot, a prop house, a wardrobe rental facility, a lighting grip rental house. The production facility will include a transportation company and an office building to house the theater and post-production facilities. Williams aims to have two sound stages operable by the first quarter of 2023. The demand for sound stages is happening globally, and the ownership rarely looks like us, let alone African-American woman, said Guidry in an official release. "When I chose to invest, I evaluate the need of the business and the ownership. Investing in Tammy Williams and her team of professionals convinced me that buying the land in Fayetteville, Georgia, and Cinema South will serve as an umbrella for Williams' production company, Tammy Dale Films. It will host an educational section of Tammy Dale Films workshops, the Cinema South Film Academy, where she will conduct the training seminars, and currently Tyler Perry Studios in Georgia is the largest film production studio in the United States, and established Tyler Perry is the first African-American to outright earn film production studio. All right, that's a good thing. So they have more than 100 descendants of Black displaced families apply for homes in Santa Monica. So the city of Santa Monica, so over more than 100 people whose families were forced out of the Santa Monica during the construction of the 10 freeway and other projects decades ago, have applied for new housing opportunities offered by a city program. In a move to right a historic wrong, Santa Monica City Council member Kristen McCowan stated that the below market housing pilot program, which launched in January, looks to match families and their descendants who are displaced during urban development projects in the city during the 1950s and the 1960s. When African-American neighborhood thrived in the Belmar Triangle until the 1950s, when it literally went up in smoke in the name of urban renewal, according to the city's website. The land was taken by eminent domain to make way for the city's expanded civic center, which included an auditorium and the Los Angeles County Courthouse. The city burned down homes and businesses, both rented and owned by African Americans and other marginalized groups. An estimated 600 families lost their homes when the I-10 was built through the Pico neighborhood. And so we created this program in earnest hope that the former Santa Monica residents take advantage of this new affordable housing opportunity, the mayor stated in a statement that if you know the community members who were displaced in the 50s and 60s, we ask for your assistance in sharing the pilot information so we can identify as many candidates as possible. The program will provide priority in the city-funded housing and inclusionary housing for up to 100 applicants will remain open to applicants through February 22nd. Applicants can be from households or descendants of households, children or grandchildren who are displaced, said city officials. If more than 100 households apply within the first 30 days of the application period, a lottery will be conducted. While the city program initially will only be open to 100 displaced families or their descendants who earn limited incomes, city leaders hope their efforts will grow into a national model to address past racist policies. Nationwide, more than 1 million people lost their homes in just the first two decades of interstate construction alone, as highway planners targeted many black neighborhoods for destruction and displaced families often received with little compensation. And wow, man, people, they actually burned these people's houses and businesses down, man, almost like they did in Tulsa. And this was in the 50s and the 60s. Wow. Crazy, man. Crazy. Yep. So they got Eric Schmidt. The system that locked up an innocent man matters more than justice. That's what he's stating. Wednesday, Attorney General Eric Schmidt tried to defend his disgraceful behavior in the Kevin Strickland case and failed miserably again. Strickland, you'll recall, spent more than 40 years in a Missouri prison for a crime he did not commit. A judge released him last year after Jackson County prosecutor Baker acknowledged the state's profound mistake in convicting and incarcerating an innocent man. Before the ruling, Schmidt tried desperately to prevent Strickland's release from custody. He claimed the court and the prosecutor could not be fair. He filed delaying motions and appeals. He fought at every turn to keep the innocent man behind bars. Wednesday, Missouri State Representative Bosley of St. Louis asked Schmidt to explain his behavior. Obviously, this is a heavy issue, Schmidt shrugged. There had been a conviction, obviously by a jury of his peers, the attorney general continued. The 1979 jury that convicted Strickland was all white. Black people were intentionally struck from the jury pool. Strickland is black. Excuse me. The attorney general insisted he needed to test the evidence in the case. We have an adversarial system, he told the House Budget Committee. That's the role that we played for 200 years in the office. Whose interest was Schmidt protecting when he butted into the case? Strickland's adversary has been the state for 43 years. It convicted him on flimsy evidence, denied his appeals, and kept him behind bars for something he did not do. When Baker recognized the error of the conviction, she asked for the court to overturn it. She was the state's representative. She asked the judge to weigh the evidence of Strickland's innocence and issue a ruling. That should have been the end of it. Schmidt, who was a candidate for higher office, had other plans. What the attorney general said Wednesday is that the truth doesn't matter, that obeying the corrupt system that puts Strickland in jail is more important than seeing justice done. It's appalling for any lawyer to suggest that, but it is beyond imagining for an attorney general. Has this really been the practice of the office for over 200 years? How many other innocent people were put in jail and are still in jail because the attorney general doesn't care about the defendant's actual guilt or innocence? Schmidt didn't say he had an opportunity Wednesday to apologize to Kevin Strickland on behalf of the state he claims to represent. He did not do so. So let's be clear. The state of Missouri's only interest in criminal cases is to make sure the guilty are punished and the innocent or not. Schmidt failed that test egregiously, and his ham-handed explanation Wednesday deepens our conclusion that he is unfit for public office. He's unfit for public office. And here's another unfit son of a gun here. A federal judge ruled that Trump can be held civically liable for the Capitol riot. He also said Trump does not have absolute immunity from civil suits. The court well understands the gravity of his decision, the ruling said, but the alleged facts of the case are without precedent. A federal judge ruled on Friday that former President Donald Trump can be held civically liable for the deadly Capitol riot on January 6, 2021. That's right. Trump's speech before his supporters stormed the Capitol, during which he called on them to fight like hell against the 2020 election results, can reasonably be viewed as a call for collective action. The U.S. District Judge Maeda wrote in a 112-page ruling. He pointed to specific statements which Trump used, and the word we included. We will not take it anymore. We will stop the steal. We will never give up. We will never concede. All Mike Pence has to do is send it back to the states to recertify, and we become president. We're going to walk down the Pennsylvania Avenue. The word we being used repeatedly in its context implies that the president and rallygoers would be acting together toward a common goal, Maeda wrote. This is the essence of a civil conspiracy. The focus on Maeda's ruling were three civil lawsuits brought against Trump by Democratic lawmakers and Capitol Police officers who defended the building on January 6th. The judge ruled Friday that Trump is not immune from litigation and can be held accountable for his actions and statements related to the Capitol riot. Maeda acknowledged the import of his decision, but said the events of January 6th were unprecedented. Wow. They said to deny a president immunity from civil damages is no small step, the ruling said. The court well understands the gravity of the decision, but the facts of the case are without precedent. Thank you. Lock him up. Lock him up. KP's Video News, y'all. Doing a shorty today.